also have the panel at Distinguished University. This panel, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Professor Kimi Akinde. So, we are going to make this session a little bit snappy. It's not going to drag like the last session because one, we have just 3 people on this particular panel, and 2, we need to keep to the timeline, which is 6 o'clock. System, we will use that opportunity to invite some other people to talk to us for not more than 10 minutes. So I'm going to pass the mic to the MC to invite the speakers.
Thank you so much, Father. We appreciate your graciousness. We want to use this opportunity to call on Mr. Zach Idris to give us a quick presentation. While our panelists make themselves comfortable and ready for their presentation. Thank you. Let us give him a round of applause.
Good afternoon. My name is Zachary Idris. Last name Idris, spelled I-D-R-I-S. I'm from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Well, I'm originally from Borno State, but I'm sure some of you might be surprised by the tribal mark on my face. So originally my parents are from Kogi State. Well, I'm here to actually address the issue of community outreach, as well as what we diasporans are doing on behalf of Nigerians. We have a program and a platform called Haskim Fatila. For those who understand Hausa, Haskim Fatila means the glow of the land. So this platform was originally created between myself and Achilles, as well as Mr. Wale. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are glad to let you know that all the stigma about Nigerians overseas involved with other activities that are not becoming. I'm glad to announce here in the house today that we're working in conjunction with the Office of Counterterrorism of the United States, and I'm glad to announce we have people from the headquarters and the floor. Can you give them a round of applause, please? So the issue we're about to address is issue of security, investor confidence in Nigeria, as well as safety net. So what we've been trying to do in the United States is creating a community outreach. Community outreach whereby we can provide safety for Nigerians in the United States as well as Nigerians in Nigeria. So we've been able to at least coordinate with the United States government to create this community outreach in Philadelphia, Delaware, as well as Maryland. So one of the things we actually did is we created a platform called Haskim Fatila Blog Talk Radio. We have done our maiden broadcast to Nigeria and around the world. So, and the first topic we talked about was the issue, the socio-political implication of Boko Haram activities in northern Nigeria. So this is one of the issues we're addressing. Additionally, however, we've been able to work using the IT platform. We'll be talking about IT this morning. But what is this IT platform we're using? We're using the social media, the Twitter handle, Facebook, as well as the internet. We're reaching over 80 million Hausa-speaking Nigerians, as well as some other Nigerians in Niger, Chad, and other West African countries. Our maiden broadcast was in English, but it is our intention to actually carry it to another level. What are the key factors that we have? Like I said, providing safety, security for Nigerians here in the United States, as well as Nigerians in Nigeria. And like I said, we work with the office of the CTC unit of the United States government to provide this outreach. Another thing we have in mind is this. We talk about investor confidence, going over to Nigeria to invest. Let's be honest with ourselves. There's no investor that will put out his resources in an environment where there's no safety, an environment where there's no security, an environment where there's no accountability, as well as transparency. So these are the factors that we all need to take into consideration when we talk about bringing investment back to Nigeria. So what we're trying to do, like I said, we Nigerians, or people of Nigerian extract in the United States, are doing what we can for the best of our kids and generation to come, to provide the safety of our people in the United States as well as in Nigeria. Lastly, what are the collective efforts we're trying to do? One other thing is this. We're transparent, we're open, we're non-affiliated to any group, so that at least we can use that platform to address these issues. And let me announce here as well, for those Nigerians in the United States, please feel free to reach out to us. And we intend to take this outreach to all the states of the Federation. Thank you very much.
Recognize the presence of Pastor Gandhi Olawale, is the head of the special project for Redeemed Christian Church of God, North America. You're welcome, sir. And over to the...
Thank you very much. When you have three professors on the panel, it's pretty easy to get carried away. They like to pour their knowledge to you at once. But unfortunately, we don't have that time. So I'm going to limit them to 10 minutes maximum for each presentation. 10 max. Yeah, 10. And when it is 10, I take the mic from you. That's 30 minutes there. And we're going to have 20 minutes discussion. This gathering is meant to be very interactive. So if you didn't have enough opportunity for your presentation, you still have opportunity during discussion. Because we are scheduled to end this panel by 6 o'clock. So now that you know upfront, you need to describe the way you intend to make your presentation so that you have fit into 10 minutes. At this point, it's my pleasure to invite Mr. Daniel Omofuoma for his presentation.
Knowledge is about you and I. Me, I have limited time, In the 21st century we are today, we cannot play around it. Knowledge is it's you and knowledge is me. And of course, intellectual capacity needs to be managed. And ICT, of course, information and communication technology, is about gathering of information, passing of information, management of information, and also dissemination of information, storage of information. And we have different types of fields of ICT. And the same all linked together. You might be wondering what's radio frequency, what's RFID. It's a household name today in Nigeria. I believe we just concluded the election was conducted on RFID technology-based solution. In the course of my presentation, you're going to learn more. RFID, of course, really stands for radio frequency identification, which, of course, it's an enabler technology that it's used for the process of identification, track, trace of people, animal, and processes. And the interesting part of it is that RFID has got multiple applications across industrial sectors. The pictures you have there in the diagram is the components of RFID. On the left hand side you have the tag. That of course can be attached to any item, can be embedded into any product, and can be implanted into any human. You might be wondering, you know. And also we have the middleware, which is talking to the readers. We have the readers that transport the radio waves, and the backend database, which is your application. And below it, you have drawings and the pictures of an RFID system in place. Because of my time, I will not be too technical with you, but I will just take you through the benefits of RFID. It has wonderful benefits. Like I said, it's an enabler. You all have your plans here in the United States. We have the Easy Pass, I live in Dallas too. We have the entity in Dallas too. So we have our key cards, our hotel room key cards. We have so many RFID applications across and within us in our everyday life. And we have RFID improving productivity and cost avoidance. Also, it decreases cycle time. Take for instance, you need to identify each and every one of the assets here with RFID seamless. With RFID is fast and with RFID is smart. And also we reduce business risk. In the oil and gas sector, they have quite a lot of assets moving from one point to another point and they need to know where they are in real time. RFID solves all this. And last but not least, they enhance better management. Where in the Nigerian house, if I'm not mistaken, they have a lot of assets here. Take for instance, they need to locate the mic. One of the mics need to be located and it's somewhere around. And it's going to take time to locate it because we have to start looking for it. But with RFID, we can scan and check through the backlog to know where the last place the mic was at. And of course, RFID has been used to fight terrorism, whether it's economic sabotage, emergency transport, or health issues, like the state of Texas. The Texas Ministry Health Department, they deployed RFID in major hospitals, majorly for equipment and access tracking. Believe me, in the healthcare sector, it takes more than 20 minutes to locate a wheelchair in Africa. Most especially in Nigeria, it takes about 30 minutes to locate a wheelchair. It might be some in one room or one of the wards, but nobody can really tell where it was or the last time it was there. So RFID is an enabler. Also, with RFID, you can deploy any warning and preventive systems, which of course is the major problem of our country, Nigeria, maintenance. We have built infrastructure over the years, billions of dollars and billions of naira have been invested in, but believe me, you can't really tell when a particular asset needs to be serviced, because it's not smart, it's not intelligent, it's not communicating with the maintenance guys. So it's not maintained but until it's packed up. So with RFID technology, all this can be resolved. Interesting thing about RFID, very, very interesting thing is that it's got applications across multiple sectors, from healthcare to transportation, from homeland security to housing, got multiple applications. Across industrial sectors, in the agricultural sector, RFID can be used for animal identification, input quality control and tracking. I'm sure you're all aware of the Agri Transformation Agenda, ATA, by Dr. Adesanya, the outgoing Minister of Agri. He deployed RFID to control the fraud involved in the fertilizer process in Nigeria, the fertilizer supply chain. And that's one of the best things the ministry has been able to achieve all through this pandemic. And also in the aviation industry, we have issues with aircraft maintenance. You can't really tell when a particular part needs to be serviced, needs to be changed, or needs to be replaced otherwise. With RFID technology in the aviation sector, you can deploy component management system, which is currently being deployed by the Nigerian College of Aviation Technology in Zaire. I happen to be advising them on that. And then with RFID, they're able to control the maintenance of their fleet, air fleet, and also the stores and the plants. Also in the oil and gas, which contributes 70% of the nation's economy, we have product monitoring and tracking, equipment management, like I said earlier on, is critical. These are infrastructures. They're not working well because we really can't tell where they are at a particular time. There's no end-to-end visibility. A particular equipment is needed for emergency, is needed to solve critical problems, but it takes more than the expected time to locate it. But believe me, with RFID, we'll be able to solve some of these problems. And then defense and homeland security, armory management and tracking system, we have issues in the past where the armories and arms made for the military are found in the hands of insurgents. You keep wondering, how come? How did you get there? Because there's no end-to-end visibility. You can't tell where it is, who is with, and what time is it being given back. So we have a lot of applications across multiple sectors. In healthcare, we also have patient monitoring. It's critical. Sometimes you have large hospitals, you really can't tell where a particular patient is. So, in Benue State today, the state government has decided to tattoo any HIV patient. Can imagine how that is going down. And they're not just placing it to the forehead, they're placing it towards the organ. So there's a particular tattoo that will be attached to everybody that has tested HIV in Benue State. That's already causing a problem. The global RFID deployment, we're here today in the United States, and they always take the lead. Interesting thing is that we have 50 RFID centers in the world. The RFID Center, African University, happens to be the first and only in Africa. You can check that. 50 in the world, 48 in the United States. And they have done so well. A few are springing out of Europe, some are more coming out of Asia. But Africa is still behind. And Africa is greenfield because we have a lot of RFID opportunities. We cannot fight corruption, we cannot ensure security without visibility of people, processes, and assets. Take for instance, like she mentioned, the fire is leaving one office to the other office. You should be able to tell in real time where the fire is going. An asset is leaving one office to the other office. You should be able to tell where it's going. So the US Department of Defense has deployed RFID long before now in the assets and equipment tracking. And I think it's time the Nigerian government look at that, deploy it for the military. We have issues of insurgency, it took them time. Way more time. Inventory was part of their problem. Equipment supply and logistics was part of the problem they were facing in the Northeast. And Hong Kong is taking the lead also in deploying RFID for the airport system. They have a very huge airport with multiple terminals. And in real time, they can tell you how many bags are coming in the airport, how many luggage are coming in, how many are going out. And with that, they've been able to prevent theft and loss. Also, Italian Civil Protection Department, they're taking the lead, deploying RFID for civil protection, and they're collaborating with private companies. It's quite much. The King Hamad University Hospital in Saudi Arabia is taking the lead. The Agri Bank of China is also deploying RFID, and also the Danish Bank and Food Council is deploying RFID. You might be wondering what's happening in Nigeria. Myself and a few other Diasporans are taking the lead, and we are pushing the Honorable Minister the coordinating minister of the economy, the outgoing minister of finance, Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, who happens to be the board chair of the Nelson Mandela Institute, registered here in Delaware. And she gave us accommodation. She gave us a new way to set up the RFID research center. And by its grace, I'm representing the International RFID Business Association in Nigeria, the Sub-Saharan region. And we have the first RFID center, and we've been able to initiate programs like the RFID Education Technology Development and Empowerment Program, which we got 2,500 young Nigerian undergraduates, and professionals involved. And we've been taking them through basics of RFID, and with that we're able to support INEC in the just concluded election. And we're working with undergraduates, university students, computer science, physics, mathematics, because we're looking at building capacity, which is critical. There are a lot of wonderful solutions out there, but we have to build the local capacity so we'll be able to support whatever we deploy. And then you're aware, next. Some of the infrastructure development of RFID in Nigeria, like the Petroleum Equalization Fund, PEF, they're in charge of bridging the products between the depot and the stations. Most times, so products just get missing. Some marketers just come back requesting for more money, but with RFID technology, the board have been able to cut off some sort of leakages and also being able to ensure that products are delivered to the stations in real time. Like you can see that, an RFID tag attached to a tanker. As it loads, it's recorded, and it's offloading, it's recorded. And also, INEC is taking all the board lead too. Now we have the smart voters accreditation system in Nigeria, which is taking the lead in Africa. In the just concluded election, RFID system was deployed. I'm sure some of us here have our smart card, BBCI, I have mine, because I was around then. It's interesting, very interesting technology. A lot of Nigerians were worried, but believe me, it helped a lot. And I believe in by 2019, we're going to see the benefit of it. I was practically involved in the entire process, advice, and I was there to help the commission. And the challenges we're facing in getting RFID fully deployed in Nigeria is not limited to legislation and political will. I'm aware RFID brings transparency and accountability. And in that region, that's a major problem. We really don't want that. Some of us want development, some of us want good things, but we don't want to be accountable for anything. But with RFID, you can tell who's responsible for what. Because at every point, if you're attached to take this table, it shows that Dan is taking this table out of this building, and he took it out 6 years. So we're having issues of education, funding, and also we need the diaspora interest and support. I will be looking forward to collaborations with universities, Nigerians, diaspora who are interested in, and also government institutions that are interested in developing RFID technology in Nigeria, and I'm recommending for the RFID Alliance initiative, which we're already working on, and also funding and expansion of the RFID technology development and empowerment program, and integration of RFID technology into existing critical national infrastructures. We're building more than 20 power plants, they don't have any plan for MRO. You can't tell when a particular plant is down until it backs up. So we're talking to the Ministry of Power, the Niger Delta Power Holding Company, and the NIPP to adopt RFID technology. We have issues in our refineries to be a while because they don't do annual maintenance or turnaround maintenance. Until the refineries are backed up, nobody's responsible, nobody's concerned. So we're calling for the integration of RFID into these infrastructures. Believe me, RFID has got a lot to do to help Africa. And if we all come together to be able to look at the potentials of RFID, how we can support it, get it going in Africa, we're going to get Africa to be there where we want it to be, and we're going to achieve the Vision 2020 in Nigeria. I'll say thank you for now because my limited time, my presentation is available. Really, I can have it over to you and I'm open for any discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellent presentation. Apology for cutting this short. That's all my fault. Yeah, I'm sure we now know better about RFID and what it can do. I'm particularly excited to learn that it was here during the last election. Great one. While the presenter was making his presentation, my bill Doga just text you. You remember I got a second term to sit here because he couldn't. The real owner of the seat wasn't around. And he picked on that, my big boss, Dr. Shola Afalabi, just stepped in. Please stand up for the recognition. Excellent. You are most welcome. So we quickly go to the second presentation, and that is from Professor Agnes Schaft. Can we have the professor?
Things that are offered, and I may per hour or per usage. So if I use a lot in 1 month, I pay accordingly. If I don't use, I don't pay, etc. Just like your phone number, your phone, you can use the minutes. The more minutes you use, the more you pay. The less minutes you, the less you pay. There's a lot of definitions for a cloud. Some, they say that the cloud, the name of cloud was, is because things are happening in the cloud. But the real definition, the cloud is really a data center, which has infrastructure, which has software, which has application software, platform software. So you, it is a, the reason why they call it the cloud is every time they use the cloud, they draw the cloud symbol to show that this is, so because of this it came out to be a cloud. But really a cloud is just utility computing, using, borrowing, renting, utility computing, be it software or hardware. There are many players in the market. The major players are Amazon, Google, App Engine, Microsoft, Azure, many other companies. There are hundreds of companies worldwide that are providing this service to the customers. And anybody can be a player and can open their company. So how does this, does it work? You can access the cloud just like you access a consumer product. You rent it, you pay for it as much as you use it. You use it more, you pay more. You use less, you pay less. And this cloud service is, for example, here in the past, not every company could produce, make up their own IC chips. Not everybody. But they had design, so they have the design, they send it to a company that produces this ICD, and they pay as much as they use. Same thing, the same concept. I use the facilities, I use 100 server or 1,000 server or less or more in order for me to achieve my goals. There's a lot of power for the cloud. There's a lot of advantages which we're not going to go through all of them, but I'll see the slides are available. You're welcome to take them. The players, as I say, many players are there. There are many platforms, many computer services that are there. In the SaaS, for example, software as a service, you have Google, Docs, QuickBase, Salesforce.com. All these are companies that makes you able to create an application with the touch of a mouse. You don't have to be a programmer. For the heavy-duty programming, you need to learn new languages, such as MapReduce, Pigs, Hive, and other languages for the heavy stuff. But for regular things, for example, if you want to sell, let's say somebody wants to open a company in Nigeria and selling custom clothes or traditional clothes, you can do this and you can market all over the world. And people will say, will buy, and you send, ship them. You don't have to have infrastructure, you don't have to have, all what you need is just a storage, and then you sell. The company takes, the Google will take care of billing, will take care of everything else, security as well, etc. The platform as a service, or let's say the layer, the infrastructure as a service, you could see there are many, items that are offered for the user to use. Now, there are many different cloud computing deployment methods. One of them is public clouds, where everybody, you can share, you can rent, you can borrow. The future is actually not for you to carry your own PC, but actually to have what we call a PC as a service. So all what you need is a connection to the internet, and you can have your own PC traveling anywhere you want without having being afraid that the system will be lost or being stolen. Or hybrid, which uses private plus public, or private, which is just a company, a big company might have its own cloud. This is just some samples. For example, you see here that the small and medium enterprises can be actually, they don't have to have their own infrastructure. They can just borrow the cloud and use the cloud, lease the cloud, and use it as much as they want. There are many models. These are the most famous models: infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service. And there are many other things. We have now communication as a service, virtualization as a service, hardware as a service, PC, personal computer as a service, etc. The evolution of computing is astonishing. There are billions of dollars. The average is expected by 2060, by next year, that the cloud computing will provide about $16 billion to the USA economy. And so this is something huge, something big, and this is something that it's easy to use. Once you have the internet capabilities, you should be able to use the internet, the cloud. Why cloud computing? Because there are many advantages for cloud. Large scale incentive, data incentive applications, you have flexibility, you have scalability, you have a customer that you can adapt, you can use as much as you need. You don't need to use more than what you need. It's effective, reduces cost, reduces startup cost, it reduces pollution in the world, it maximizes the utilities of the system, because the cloud came actually during Christmas time, where companies had to include a lot of infrastructure, but after Christmas, the computers are not used. So the idea came is let everybody use them. So this is really the intention. So here, flexibility, you can go on. Scalability, if you need one computer, you can rent one. You need 100 computers, you can rent 100. If you have at one time 1,000 customers, then 1,000 nodes will be immediately scaled for you, so that you will never wait on the line until, like in the past, as an internet application where you have one server. So if you have too many people, you will basically lose customers. Here, it scales as much as you want. It's customized. You can customize it to your own needs. It's very cost effective because it's pay as you go. It is like utilities. It's like using electricity at home. Use more, you pay more. Use less, you pay less. Maintenance, you don't have to, as a company, you don't have an IT, you don't need a big IT department or ICT, information and communication and technology department. Why? Because this is all done by those cloud providers. You only need maybe one or two, if you have a big company, to train the people on the use of certain software. Sometimes you don't even need an IT department completely, because you don't need it. It's all done by the cloud providers. Again, here you see some of the availability, the advantages of it. The drawbacks, everything has good advantages and also has drawbacks or disadvantages. Some of the disadvantages of the cloud, and that's why it's taken a while. I would say about a month ago, Google's stock market, Amazon stock market went by $57 in one day. Went up. Why? Because the usage of their cloud increased by 15%. So that and companies are coming to the cloud in the future. Everybody will use the cloud. Some of the drawbacks that why not everybody is using cloud now is because of security. It's still, we have some issues with security, and there's a lot of research in this area, as well as privacy. Privacy also, when you put your data, is it, where is it? Which data center is it? Is it the European data center, or is it in South America, or is it in North America, etc.? Vendor lock, you have some companies that they use their own software, so it becomes hard for you to migrate to another cloud for a cheaper rate, because you're stuck. You're using this system, it's very hard to move to another company. Network dependency, because if the network is down, the network is slow, your cloud will also be slow. Migration, again, also because some companies, they have their own software. This is changing now, because what happened, the cloud, they have now consortiums with the new standardization to reduce some of these drawbacks. These are some of the challenges, which means that there are a lot of opportunities open to resolve or to go over some of these challenges. I'll stop. I don't want to talk too much, because I think 10 minutes is more than enough. But if you have more questions, you can address them later on.
Thank you very much, Professor Shout. Professor Shout has broken down the concept of cloud in a very simple manner, to the extent that My wife seated over there, who is not an IT person, will probably lecture out and in the very near future. Gave us the definition of cloud computing, and that the cloud is now a consumer product pay as you go. We defined all the platforms in the cloud, PaaS, SaaS, IaaS, so on. We enumerated so much advantages to the cloud. And we were very honest. To even point out to the drawbacks, I think that was quite honest of him. The issue of security he mentioned to a large extent. To a greater extent, he marketed cloud computing and stated that he has a cloud computing company somewhere because of the great job he's done in his marketing. Anyway, thank you very much for that excellent presentation. Can we give him another round? We go to the last presentation today, and after the presentation, we are going to have a remark from the owner of this seat that I'm sitting on. He's going to give us a talk for a few minutes. So may I invite to the podium another professor from the University of Michigan, Professor Kumi Akinbeyi. You're welcome, sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We have listened to many excellent presentations and discussions today. I would like to piggyback on most of those discussions. My focus would be security. Not the good old security of a handguard with an AK-47 and a gun and highly barricaded doors, but electronic security. Or cyber security. I'll talk about cyber security, then I want to talk about authentication and encryption, two techniques to cyber security, and then I want to talk about Nigeria and what we have to do in Nigeria. We in Nigeria, we have to be proactive. We the good guys have to be one step ahead of the bad guys. So we can do that in a few minutes. Next slide. In very simplistic terminology, cybersecurity has to do with the storage of information on computers or similar devices. And security when we transmit such information from one location to another location. Next slide, please. I have a very simple model here. We have two stations. Sending information between themselves. The decisions could be you trying to log on to your bank account. It could be you trying to browse the web. It could be somebody trying to make a call, look at the cell phone. It can also be just a single station, like your computer and you. So we look at three types of security, at the station, in between the two stations, and at the second station. We can have a breach at any of these three locations. Next slide, please. We are all familiar with authentication. Very simple concept. Prove to me that you are who you claim to be. And what we do most of the time is we type a logon ID and then we type a password. Oh, that's good enough for most purposes. Next slide, please. There's another type of security called encryption. Next slide, please. Okay, next slide. Next slide, we'll come back. Okay. Encryption is when you take information and you change it in such a way that nobody can understand the information. Now, we don't do that most of the time, or we are not aware of it being done, but believe me, it's being done all the time. It's being done on your behalf by the web browser. When you log on with your password and your logon ID and it goes over the web to your bank, the web browser will encrypt your information. It takes human readable information and makes it non-readable. Now let's go back to three slides to authentication. Okay, the next slide. Okay. When you log on, that's called a password-based authentication.
is done by you. The other type is done by the web browser. It's called certificate-based authentication. For that, the web browser uses a certificate to authenticate you on your behalf. We don't know it, but it goes on all the time. And the easy way to know that the web browser is doing its job and your information is being encrypted, if you look at the web address of your current site, if you have an HTTPS for security, any information from that site is being encrypted. Now, what do I mean by encryption? Let's move on about three slides, please. Okay. Encryption is when you take unreadable information and you make it unreadable. Next slide, please. To do that, you need two things. You need an algorithm and a key. The algorithm used to encrypt is known to everybody, but the key is only known to you and to the recipient of your information. So you will use the key to encrypt, and the recipient will use the key to decrypt the information. Next slide, please. I have a simple example here. We want to encrypt the word J-O-H-N. Our algorithm is very simple. It says multiply each letter by 2, subtract the key, add the key, and then divide the 0 by 2. That is the algorithm. What is not obvious is the key. The key is unique and it's only known to you and to the recipient of that information. Now, in the case of J-O-H-N, back to that slide, if we encrypt John, if you look at the last line, when it goes across the web, it becomes that garbage that we see at the end. It's like S, right braces, O, left braces. That's encrypted. That can be decrypted by the receiver of the transmission. Next slide, please. There are two types of encryption. One is called a private key encryption. You need a single key for that. The sender and the receiver need to have the same key. So the sender can encrypt that key and the receiver can decrypt with that same key. Next slide, please. And that's the picture. So here we send a dear Ali, I love, blah, blah, blah. And when we encrypt it, that's what it looks like, scrambled. And then we decrypt, and that looks like regular transmission. Next slide, please. Now, this other type of encryption is called public key encryption. That's what is used by the banks. That's more complex. I will not go into the details of public key encryption because of time constraints. Next slide, please. But for that, you need a public key and a private key. Two keys. Next slide, please. I'm sorry. Back to that previous slide. One more slide. Okay. If you look at the last paragraph there, now, we have two keys, a public key and a private key. What that means to us that, let's take the case of a bank. The private key is held by the bank. Only the bank has a private key. The public key is not to everybody. Everybody, all the great brothers have a public key. To summarize though, what that means is that, if you look at the last paragraph, it says anybody can send encrypted information to the bank, but only the bank can decrypt and understand the information. That is because the bank is the only person that has a private key, but all of us have the public keys through our web browser. Okay, two slides, one of these. Next slide. These are some other security techniques I won't spend time on. Now, let's look at Nigeria. We are lucky in Nigeria. We don't have that much cyber security threats in Nigeria. Most we have is impersonation. Somebody tries to impersonate somebody else by email or by using an ATM card. We also have people that monitor information that goes over the web and they try to steal information from that source. What some of us know is that, in fact, most of us may know that, in the banking industry in Nigeria, if you look at the last paragraph there, most breaches are committed by in-house employees, not by the customers, by the employees employed by the bank. Next slide, please. We can do things to improve our situation. We need more political awareness, government involvement, private industry involvement. We need to be centered on ourselves. investment and training and education. Next slide, please. And my last slide is what I mentioned before. We are not that much advanced in cyber security, and it's not that needed much today. But times are changing, the days of the old time of paper records are gone. We are using computers. We need a proactive approach. It's more economical, it's more effective than a reactive approach. We should be ahead of the bad guys and take steps to combat security in cyberspace. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Professor Akinbeyin has done an excellent job in breaking down that very difficult topic for everybody's understanding. I have a question after. Maybe I should ask now. I want to know who is just the case. But we take that during discussion. So before we go into discussion, may I invite the big boss to please get some few remarks.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've listened at least to the two very interesting presentations which kind of represent all that we've heard. And I just want to go back to the beginning. Let's go back to the beginning. And the two crops I see from the quantity of gray hair that they have will understand when I start putting some dates. When I started learning computer science in 1970, things were slightly different from now. And then we went on to, at that time it was a matter of, do we have centralized computing or we are going to have distributed computing? This was in the middle of the 70s. And somewhere about that time, towards the end of the 70s and early 80s, you had the personal computing that gave you power at an individual level, right? Good. Then, which came from the distributed computing philosophy, that we should be able to, we should allow the nodes to do as much processing as possible. Because then we have many frames that were about as big as this room, and their air conditioners were about twice as big as this room. But then they were called main frames. They were really frames. Then we discovered that with the personal computing, there was too much power in your hand. There was too much idle computing. You had too much power, and you needed so many things that were out there that you couldn't reach, and then we started putting these things together. And if you look at the picture that was shown by Prof when he was showing what is cloud computing, you saw that big array of what they call the data center now. In principle, that was what the mainframe looked like. So we are moving very quickly towards the past.
I have to stop a little bit for my friend, His Excellency. Don't worry, no, he can take my seat, I'll find someone. Your Excellency, you are highly welcome. His Excellency, by his own right, is a professor, and we were colleagues in a distant past before he entered this room. Thank you very much for sparing the time and for honoring us in this. Because he's still possibly going to make some comments, I'll run up. So we are moving gradually towards the past, and what we have done before, we are trying to do it again using different terminologies, using different encryptions, and so on and so forth. But basically, in computing, there is nothing new. The basic thing, you want some machines to do some things that you are doing manually, and you could do it distributed, or you could do it central. The problem is, cloud now is moving to central, but with some advantages that have been probably explained to us. And we are happy that we are moving together. Now for the future of the NI, how do you call this thing? NI?
NiDICT.
The future of NiDICT. This is nice, but I think in the future we are going to start looking at bringing the experts here and the experts in Nigeria together, and the businesses, the brains that are here, and the opportunities that are there. RFID that was explained to us, he carefully didn't say how much money he made when he was consulting for INET, and he didn't say that. But basically, ladies and gentlemen, that's why we are here. You want to use the intellect and the expertise you have to make money. Yes, you are going to serve your country, but you are also going to make money. Basically, that's it. And that's why in the future, either we do the next ones here or back home, in which we bring businesses, banks, and those who need your services, and you come with the ideas, and you meet some of those who are in Nigeria who actually came from here, and what they have been able to do, and how you too can benefit from it. We'll do some bit of the lecturing and so on, but we are also going to have more of the business to consultant sessions. And those of us who left too long ago, I think I left in 1979, we left too long ago, we don't know what it is, you will come back and tell us exactly what it is, and if it is possible for us to come back and lecture at the University of Michigan. No, I've retired three times now, so I'm ready to start another set. Once again, the organizers, you are wonderful. I thank you very much. Thank you.
The issues we are discussing, and you will have opportunity to also give us some remarks. So now we have very limited time to go to discussion. Time is fast spent. So you are welcome to make remarks, ask questions. The panelists are here to respond to your questions. Please keep your remarks a little bit brief and introduce yourself before you speak. Comments, questions?
Federal Commissioner of the Federal Character Commission,
Concerning the cloud computing, yes, we said it's not really in terms of security. But I felt that is this cloud computing not really keeping us, especially in Africa, away from building infrastructure, you know, creating our own storage devices, because now it's cheaper. It's cheaper now to use the cloud computing, it's cheaper now to host on the cloud service. But how will that affect us? I'm talking about us as Africans. How will that affect us in terms of developing our own capacity and then getting our political actors to think about building infrastructure for us that we can say this is our own and that we can actually rely on in case of any eventuality? But finally, I want to ask, what percentage of companies have been hosted on the cloud computing now? Is it advisable for governments to take their data and then host it on cloud computing and then rely on that? What happens if there is any diplomatic war between where the data is and where it's also being hosted? Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Zachary Idris once again. The question I have is, I'm sure one of the speakers talked about the potential of Nigerians, you know, the IT experience and what have you. But, you know, just to put it out there, you know, at a point in time, you have over 10 Nigerians working for Thompson Financial as consultant for New York Stock Exchange. But this individual I'm talking to you, some of them try to make investment in Nigeria. So the question is this: what are the incentives in terms of government legislation, policies, or what have you, that can attract, just like this individual talked about RFID, right? So what encouragement are we giving Nigerians to actually take this knowledge to greater height? And lastly, in terms of security, do we actually have a national policy using all this technology, experience, and what have you, to be able to tackle issue of terrorism, just like issue of tracking our arms and ammunition or what have you? Thank you.
Any other one?
For this wonderful opportunity, I believe in this dream, and for giving us the opportunity to use this dream. The question is this, that there are a lot of opportunities in Nigeria, and is there anything in the embassy that can allow the platform for students in the diaspora, as well as the area of ICT? And also to use the database, the surrounding system for ICT professionals that are available at the embassy here. And secondly, as part of looking at that transition between the diaspora and the rest of the professionals that are starting to study, how do we leverage on that? You know, although we talk about the diaspora position, diaspora university, so we have it.
Awesome. 5 to 6 persons, cloud computing. We cannot deny us opportunity of developing our own local infrastructure. Do you want to pick
up? Yeah, in terms of cloud computing, there's nothing that prevents any country, any agency, any company to have their own infrastructure. The issue is not really you having your own infrastructure, is that for small companies, for mid-sized companies, for somebody who wants to start a new company, you may not have the finance to do it, but for government, definitely, there is the concept of computing cloud, community cloud. There is public, there's private, there's hybrid, there's community, there's government cloud. Those governments who can definitely, we should, because of the security problem, because we want to make sure that only certain people have access to high, people who have access to it are only officials. So you can do that definitely. The computers are cheap, but at the same time, maintaining the computers, maintaining infrastructure is not that cheap. The other thing is about security. Most companies like Google has about 3-5 data centers throughout the world. The same data is actually stored in more than one location. So you lose one, you get one. So there's what we call fault tolerance. So we can tolerate. If there's something wrong, we can still tolerate it. The data will be somewhere else. But definitely, yes, security is a very big issue. And the idea is that you don't have to go and invest your infrastructure and spend years. By the time you're done, they're not saying, go ahead, start, use them and be pioneering in applying in coming up with applications to use this infrastructure. At the same time, utilize the latest technology for maybe the future data center. The future data center may be different than what it is now. Now it's 200,000 computers put in a huge building. There's a huge cooling system, huge power system, etc.
Thank you. Can you follow up to that? Is it advisable for government to host their data outside their shop?
I'll tell you something. There is nothing 100% proof. It's always whenever you use cloud or anything, you must have a way to reserve your data. It has to be reserved. If you don't reserve it, you lose it. There is a problem with cloud in the United States. We call it somebody put bad information in Google. The government came and seized everything for a long time. So people who were innocent, they lost it. They were not able to use their data for I think 2 or 3 weeks. So there's that issue there, definitely. But as a government, you have to have a backup system. The backup system has to be there, definitely.
Another question. What are the incentives for Nigerians to take their knowledge back home? Is there any legal policy and regulation framework? I will request the ambassador to please respond to that.
That's not very fair to me. Yeah, I just told you. But you know that there is a tech control policy being proposed by the government. I'll just talk to the Minister of Government this morning on the very recent climate to meet the new coming in. And a number of questions were asked about matters pending that are yet to be resolved. One of them is the new communication policy of the government. It is still being discussed, and there are the inputs from so many companies, the IBM or more, that really ask that question, and then they will have inputs and the companies. Sometimes I put them into mobile policy, and they came there and they had some experience. But the policy is yet to be finalized, I know, and I think this government will be able to do that. But I do know that in terms of incentive, the same type of incentive that we provide for any type of professional wishing to go is also available for those in ICT. And the embassy tries to make you a wish you can be of help, to make you have a breakthrough. And we are putting to all the policies at home with regard to setting up a new business and all the policies. Framework that government is doing to ensure that we provide a conducive environment for business to grow. And details of that will be available at my staff at the Trade and Investment Center. Is Rose there? Rose, I saw her coming just now. She's there. She will be able to give you all the framework policy with regards to everyone's trying to make a new business in Nigeria. More so in Nigeria. We are particularly happy to see those of people in the diaspora going through. As I always told you, I've always said several times, you're not asking every professional here, every professional
to pack up and go back to Nigeria. If you want to stay here and be linking up with you and establish your business, you take your contacts here and operate short between the two countries to be able to make your business, you are welcome. I mean, the two countries accept their multiple nationality. Take their passport here, take their name tag, take your passport in Nigeria. When you go to Nigeria, show them your green passport. When you are coming here, show them your green card. And make the best of the world. So we do the best, and that's why we tell you, there's anybody holding an American passport in Nigeria coming for a visa. I say, give that visa to tech, make sure that when it comes and take the Nigerian passport. And that's the way we approach you. So you are able to avail yourself of developments in your area and take it to Nigeria to help us develop. So there will be a new policy on ICT. It's already been drafts are in existence. You need to see, and because it will take provision for people that are coming in and what you need to do, but that is for secular in ICT. That's what I can say now. But for details of incentives for Nigerians in any profession, way back home to study. See that you know the children investment section.
And the people also would like to answer that.
I think the sound at the end of his presentation was actually an ovation from His Excellency. Just to add to what he has said, if you attend any of the ICT functions in Nigeria, you see people who have made millions of dollars from cloud computing. Whether it is in e-commerce, or in bulk SMS, or in just liaison with the established telecoms companies. And the president of ATCOM, he is a very good source of the kind of things you could do. And ISPON also, the information software. Most of what we are going to do, you are going to do in cloud computing in Nigeria is not setting up the hardware. Is actually adding local content. Okay? There's somebody who just came using very simple cloud things to do a taxi service in Nigeria. And he's already making a lot of money. So the infrastructure is there, there are big organizations providing that. All we need is for you to come in and add some contact, some content, some local content specific to the environment and the market you want to do. And you come and take advantage of both the Indians, the Pakistanis, the South Africans. They are already taking advantage of this in Nigeria. We would prefer that it is more of Nigeria that come to do this at home. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question goes to be addressed by the RFID experts. How do we use technology to tackle terrorism?
Thank you very much. It's quite critical. But believe me, insurgency, which is terrorism, you and I know it's got to do with people who are our brothers and our sisters, but with a different mindset. Terrorism starts from the mind. And technology is a thing of also the mind. Anywhere there's identification, anywhere there's visibility, there's possible counter-terrorism in terms of processes. If we have systems in place that can identify who's coming in the country, who's going out of the country, what time is this person coming in the country, I'm very, very sure that we'll be able to control and counter-terrorism. We have fertilizer companies in Nigeria, which of course you and I know is ammonia, and that's what is used for some of these IEDs otherwise. And in Nigeria, there's no traceability for fertilizer before now. And you can move it from one point to another point without even getting clearance from the Nigerian police force. But we're able to advise them and reduce the traceability in that. So technology is really helping. I was still looking at working with the Ministry of Interior to see how we can have border control.
These are people we know, but we should be able to identify them from one point to another point. Identity is the major problem. We don't maybe go, we don't know if it's real name, we don't know which baby he is. So technology can really fight the insurgency, and it's been doing it, and I believe that if we learn from the US, we'll be able to get there, we'll be able to achieve that. Thank you.
I just want to add, we won't have to begin from scratch. There are many nations who have had more experience with terrorism, and we can learn from those nations. US can help us a lot. They've been involved with terrorism for many, many years.
Thank you. Your Excellency, before your arrival, we discussed about the initial effort that was made by previous administration to set up the Diaspora Commission. Akobi Ojo came forward to ask the question now, that about that Diaspora Commission. What is the state of the Diaspora Commission that was initially planned by the government? Do you know the state? Why are we not having it now?
All I know is that it has passed the second reading at the House of Representatives. And I think the state the Diaspora Commission bill is now in the same state as the PIB bill, Petroleum Investment Bill, is. Just the final state. And I have reason to believe that it's one task that the present parliament would like to conclude before they go. If they don't, then it's their shame. I don't know what the procedure is if the bill has already gone to second stage before the life of the parliament runs out, whether we start from scratch in the next parliament. But I think governments will continue on anyway. I don't really know what it is. But I know that it's gone to second stage. And the constant dialogue with the Ivadari has been really actually a country to Mrs. Abikendabi Ewalus, who we call the Madaswara. We thought it was part of the second stage, more or less. The final stage, there's just one small step to conclude. And so we are in support of the Diaspora Commission. For the simple fact, to relieve some of us there from the task of being with us and our Diaspora community, hopefully it should. So I think it is a question, I think is hanging. I will ask and then be able to give what it is. I can't say for sure what it is. But I know it passed with second, and we're supposed to be finally. I'm not sure that we submitted for assent, whatever it is. It's one of the few things I mean we the current government would like to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And the very last question, and that was the question from me to Professor Akikube. We discussed extensively about public case, private case. Who are the organizations usually in this case? And is my post in Nigeria, the post office, in the position to issue this case?
There are many certification agencies. They include Google, GoDaddy. You know, most of the web browsers are also certification agencies. They can issue keys and certificates. NiDICT can also become a certification agency or authority. They can apply. You just have to apply to a company called ICANN. That's the world headquarters for the internet. And they have to meet certain requirements and they can become a certification agency. I would love to see some Nigerian certification agencies. It would really be great.
Thank you very much. I happen to be a past counselor of ICANN. GNSA. So I think you can work with my post to get the approval for certification. So, excellent job. You will agree with me that this panel has done a very good job. Please can you give them a round of applause. Thank you very much.
The Nigerian Diaspora ICT Conference. I this may be a pleasure to welcome you to the Embassy of Nigeria. And from what I've seen, it's been a very successful event. For us at the embassy, anything Nigerian is always welcome. we leave our doors open for our events that contribute to the achievement of our foreign policy objectives. This is the age of computer, the age of ICT, and the country needs to be encouraged to develop along that line. I don't think anybody who is not computer literate stands a chance of getting any decent job in the world anymore. Even you find some of the younger people saying that they don't want leaders who are not computer literate anymore. But the younger generation, they are very lucky. Some of us have to learn computer when we are over 50. How to use the computer when we are over 50. But then the world is moving, and computer ICT is being taught even in primary school. So we want Nigeria to move along with the time. This is why when the proposal was brought to us at the embassy, we found no difficulty in contributing by releasing this place for use. And from what I could gather in discussion, it will be a very fruitful exercise. So anything that will push Nigeria forward in the age of ICT, they are very supportive of it. And I was just telling you about the ICT policy being currently enunciated by the government. And there are so many companies that are interested in that. IBM, many of them, they've come to me several times. I remember I had to put a call through to Ms. Johnson on the spot and discuss with them. She's been here a number of times to discuss this issue. And it shows that we are moving forward in Nigeria. Everything is computerized now. I hope they will not computerize the way we feed ourselves. It's so clear that anybody who's not computer literate has no future in this world we are moving. So against that background, I want to thank you. I want to congratulate your organizer and get more people interested. Get more of our young people interested in this ICT. Anyway, you don't need to convince anybody. Anybody wants to have any decent profession in this world has to be computer literate. So the earlier you put it on them, the presence of them, the better. So let me once again congratulate the organizers and pledge the support of both the government and this mission for any endeavor that will improve the computer literacy of Nigerians. Thank you very much and wish you success.
15. We look forward to meeting you at NiDICT 2016. Hopefully to take place in DC also. We want to thank you, those from Nigeria and those from outside Nigeria, those in the US. I will just, by way of information, add that, like we say, Baku, item 7. Item 7 is ready, just out there. Please feel free to join us there. The discussion continues. Thank you very much, and God bless you.